So today we're going to see how support vector machines work, and this is the last classifier you need to know before starting the assignment. So at the end of the second lecture, I'm going to also talk briefly about your first assignment. So we're going to start with this notion of maximum margin classifier and the notion of support vectors, which is then central to support vector machine. And then I'm going to explain how we arrive at the support vector machine. So let's start with this idea of maximizing the margin. So we saw, when we started looking at classification, we saw this example, and we tried to create a classifier by minimizing the quadratic distance to the decision line. So this discriminant line here that tells us which class each example belongs to, we try to adjust it by minimizing the distance to all the points. And we saw that this doesn't work because unlike in regression, where we want to adjust a model as much as possible to a set of points, so as close as possible to the points, in classification what we want to do is partition the space where our points lie into different regions. So it doesn't really matter where these points are, these points that are away from the frontier. All we really should care about is these points here close to the frontier, because if we get these right, then everything else will work fine. So to do this, we use logistic regression, which is also regression, but we are doing a regression to a continuous function of the probability of belonging to a class. And then when we use that to classify by setting a threshold on the probability to assign to one class or the other, we get a good result by dividing this plane into the two regions where there are the blue points and the red points. But one thing we noticed is the problem here that when we adjust this, we get a discriminant between the two different regions, between the set of points, one of each class. But we have the problem with this set of parameters, the W, the set of coefficients we're computing, because these specify a vector that is perpendicular to the discriminant line, but the dimension of this vector can be arbitrarily large. And as we increase the size of this vector, we also increase the steepness of the logistic function, and if this function is too steep, we can set the line anywhere between those two classes. So the problem here is that all of these are possible solutions for the logistic regression if we do not constrain the size of that vector. The problem with this is that if the line is too close to one example of one class, we may be overfitting, we may be losing ability to generalize, because in this training set it works fine, but if we use different examples, we increase the chance of getting them wrong. So to reduce this problem of overfitting, what we did was use regularization, where we add a term to the loss function, to the function we're trying to optimize, in order to encourage this vector to become smaller. And so we reduce the steepness of the function, and we try to force the discriminant to fall further from the points that are close to the frontier here. So in other words, what we did is we tried to maximize the margins. The margins are these distances between the discriminant and the closest points to the discriminant. So this is the basic notion. What we were trying to do to reduce overfitting in logistic regression was to try to maximize the margins, and to do that we forced our cost function to also include the size of the vector, so that the vector would be as small as possible, taking into account also the error in classification. So basically we are doing this maximization of the margin a bit indirectly by adding to the cost function this term with the sum of the squares of the coefficients to try to reduce the norm of the vector. But we could try to do this explicitly. So let's look at this concept. We have a margin classifier if we can have some measure of how far away one point is from the decision surface. So in this case, in logistic regression, we have that sigmoid function that is trying to predict the probabilities, but any classifier that allows us to measure how far away we are from the decision, the discriminant, allows us to define margins, this distance from the discriminant. A maximum margin classifier is one that tries to maximize the margin. So logistic regression without regularization would not be an example of a maximum margin classifier because it wouldn't care about the margin. By adjusting a bit the loss function, we can encourage the margin to grow, but still we are not explicitly trying to maximize the margin. So this is what we're going to try to do. We're going to create a classifier that tries to place the discriminant as far as possible from those points that are close to the frontier, because those are the points that matter. So this gives us the notion of support vectors. The support vectors are those examples in our training set that determine where the discriminant must be. Note that these examples here on this side and these red examples here, it doesn't matter where they are. They could be over here, they could be over here. It's irrelevant for this frontier. As long as these are the closest points to the frontier, these are the ones that matter, because these are the ones that will determine where we need to place the discriminant. So these are the support vectors, the examples, the vectors, the points that we have, that determine where the discriminant must be. So let's try to do this explicitly. We're going to implement a maximum margin classifier. We can measure the actual distance in the plot to the hyperplane, the discriminant, by using here our decision function. So remember that multiplying these coefficients by the example plus that constant gives us a function that is positive on one side, negative on the other. This depends on where this vector is pointing to. So this vector is pointing to the positive side. It's positive there, negative on the other. If we have classes that are 1 and minus 1, we can use that function as the discriminant. If it's positive, it's class 1. If it's negative, it's class minus 1. Of course, this value here depends on the magnitude of W. So if we want to actually measure the distance here in the plot, we need to divide everything by the magnitude of W so that it becomes independent of the scale of that vector and we can actually measure the distance. So this would be assigned distance because it's positive on one side, negative on the other, and we can multiply this by the class label. So the class label is 1 or minus 1, and that should always be positive because examples from class minus 1 should have this value negative. So minus 1 times negative will be positive, and examples from class 1 should have that value positive if everything is working fine and we are classifying them correctly. So to try to maximize the margin is to try to maximize, to find the W vector and that W0 constant that maximizes the smallest distance to the discriminant. So this would be the distance to the discriminant. The product of this vector that is perpendicular to the discriminant plus the constant, the product of the vector by the example, and then divide everything by the size of the vector so it always retains the same scale, and we multiply by the class so that this is always positive. If it's class minus 1, that value is negative and it ends up positive, and vice versa for class 1. So this would be the closest points would be the points that minimize the distance. And we want to make this smallest distance as large as possible. This is the expression of the maximum margin classifier. And this is trivial to implement. So we write this down as a cost function. So this basically, we create just a matrix for the coefficients with one column here, so that we can do this inner product with the whole data set. We do the inner product here, so we multiply all the matrix of x's by the coefficients. We get this term here, then we add the last value for the coefficients, the W0, and now we compute the distances to of all the points. So basically, we are computing all these distances, and we are returning the smallest of them. This sign change here is just that we want to maximize the distance to the closest point, but in SciPy we have the minimize function. So we just change the sign. If we minimize the negative, we are maximizing the value. So this is very easy to implement. We just basically write this down as the cost function, use the minimize function that we have to compute this maximum, and the problem is that this doesn't work. So when we run, we get garbage, and it cannot find the optimum value. Now, the reason why this doesn't work is that all these optimization algorithms depend on some kind of gradient descent. They must compute the derivative and go down the cost function that we're trying to optimize. So in minimization, we would go down the gradient of the function. The problem is that when we are changing the position of the discriminant, at some points, some points are closest, but then a different point becomes closer. And if we look at the shape of this cost function, we get something like this. There are these jagged edges here where we shift from one point being closest to a different point being closest. So we have intersections of different quadratic surfaces, but the intersection becomes discontinuous in the derivative at those points. And worse of this is that those are precisely the best points, the ones that we want to find. They lie when the discriminant is exactly at the same distance of three, in this case, support vectors, the points that are closest, and so it lies at this intersection of three different curves where the derivative is not continuous. So this is the kind of problem that seems simple to formulate, but then we don't have numerical methods to solve them because of the discontinuity in the derivative. So this is why we now must take a detour to find a way to solve this maximum margin classifier problem, to try to create a maximum margin classifier. And this is what gets us to the support vector machine. So the basic idea is simple. We want to maximize the margin. Numerically, we cannot solve that problem if we just formulate it naively. And remember that machine learning also requires that the computer be able to find the solutions for the problem. So I'm not going to give you a complete demonstration of a complete derivation of the support vector machine, but I am going to give you quite a few parts, the minimum necessary to understand what is the support vector machine, so the final expression that we get. Yes. Well, if you know the support vectors, then maximizing the margin would be finding something equidistant from those that are on one side and those that are on the other. But the problem is that you start without knowing which are the support vectors. The support vectors will be determined by that problem of maximizing the margin. To find the support vectors, you need to know where the discriminant is, because the support vectors are the ones that fix the discriminant in place. And to find the discriminant, you also need the support vectors. So basically, you need to use everything at the same time. Okay? And that's why the function then ends up like that, because as the support vectors change, also the shape of the function changes. So this is not for you to memorize all the demonstrations, but it's important. There are some concepts here that are important to understand what a support vector machine is. Okay. So let's start with what we wanted to do. We have this decision function here, so multiplying the coefficients by the example plus the constant. If we multiply that by the class, we always should have a positive value, because if our classifier is working, we are classifying the negative class with a negative value there, and the positive with the positive. This distance that we chose by dividing by the size of the vector, we did that because this retains always the same value regardless of scale. So if we multiply all the R coefficients by this beta, we also multiply, increase the size of the vector, and everything remains the same, because then we are dividing by the length of the vector. So the idea was that the actual margin, as we measure on the plot, should remain the same regardless of how we scale things. So we can set this constraint. For every example in our training set, we require that the decision function multiplied by the class of the example, so the part there in the numerator, be at least 1. This we can do because no matter how small the margin is on the graph, we can always increase the length of the vector and make this value higher. But if we impose this constraint for all the data sets, then the one way of increasing the margins would be to shift the discriminant function away from the nearest vectors, and this means that we can fulfill this constraint with a smaller size for our vector. So we can fulfill this constraint trivially, as long as the discriminant is in the right position, roughly, by increasing the size of the vector. But if we minimize the size of the vector, then we force the discriminant to be in the optimum place, because that's the only way to fulfill this constraint. So actually, our problem of trying to find the maximum distance to the closest point, or maximize the distance to the closest point, becomes just this quadratic optimization, which is to minimize the size of the vector. Or we can use the square of the size of the vector to make the function smoother. But the first point here for you to understand is this works because we are forcing this constraint. So we force the decision value for each point to be at least 1 when multiplied by the class. This we can do by increasing the size of the vector, but now we try to minimize the size of the vector, and this forces the discriminant to be at the optimum place. So this would be the problem we're going to try to solve. Minimize this, the square of the size of the vector, subject to all these constraints. Yeah. I couldn't hear, sorry. Yeah. Well, we're going to see later what happens if this has no solution, so if they are not linearly separable. But if the classes are linearly separable, then you can trivially make this larger than 1 just by increasing the size of this parameter. As long as it's larger than 0, you just increase the size of the parameters and it's larger than 1. So this is a bit arbitrary, the value we have here. And that's precisely why we now want to minimize the size of the parameters. So as long as this is fulfilled, we don't violate these constraints, we will find the minimum size of the vector that respects them. And this optimizes the position of the discriminant. Okay? So we have one constraint for each example in our data set. If we have 1,000 points in our training set, we have 1,000 constraints, because all of them must be at least 1 away from the discriminant according to that function. And we have this target function that we're trying to minimize. So we need to do a constraint optimization problem. We need to solve a constraint optimization problem. We are minimizing this function subject to all these constraints. The way we can solve this is using these Lagrange multipliers methods, or the Lagrange method. I'm going to give a simple example just to get an idea of how this works. Suppose that we have this function that we want to maximize. So this is a quadratic function, 1 minus x squared minus y squared, and we want to find the maximum for this function. But we want to find the maximum subject to that constraint, x minus y minus 1 equals to 0. So what we can think about here is that if we are going along this line, x minus y minus 1 equals to 0, this line is a contour line of that function, x minus y minus 1. So this is a function that is, it's a plane, so more or less like this, and this line is a line along that plane where the value of the function is constant. So this is called the contour line. It's a line where the value is constant. And if we find the maximum of this curved surface along that line, that means that at the point of the maximum, the derivative of this closed surface along the line must be zero. Because if it's not, if it was not, we could move a little bit further and still find a higher point. So at the maximum, we are at the place where this blue line here, which is a constraint, which is a contour line of this function, x minus y minus 1, is parallel to a contour line of the function we're trying to optimize. So this line is parallel to that that circle here, which is a contour line of this curved surface. So if the two contour lines are parallel, since the derivative of the function must be perpendicular to the contour line is a line where the value is constant, so the derivative along that line must be zero. So the derivative of the function is perpendicular to the contour line, and the two contour lines are parallel, so the two derivatives must be parallel too, since they are perpendicular to the contour line. They may be pointing the same way or the other way, we don't know that, but they must be, we must be able to write the derivative of one function as some constant times the derivative of the other. This sign here is conventional, it's usually minus, so that when we put everything on one side, we get a plus sign. But this is the idea. When we optimize one function subject to a constraint of some other function equals to a constant, we know the contour lines must be parallel, we know the derivatives must be parallel, so we have this constraint. At the maximum, this must be true. It's not necessarily that in all points that this is true, they correspond to a maximum. They may not be the global maximum and so on. But this is one way of finding the maximum subject to the constraints. This is the Lagrange method, because from here we compute the create the Lagrangian. The Lagrangian is the function we want to optimize, plus one constant multiplied by the function that has the constraint. So something equals to zero, that something, that g, that is the constraint, is the function here. And now a candidate point for the maximum subject to that constraint is a point where the derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to all these parameters, the original variables and the Lagrangian multiplier, the alpha there, is zero. Why? Because if it's a maximum, the derivative with respect to x and y must be zero. And if we meet the constraint, g must be zero too, so the derivative with respect to alpha must be zero. So this is basically a mathematical trick to put the constraint inside the same function that we want to find the optimum for. So now we are no longer just trying to optimize something with fulfilling some constraint. We put everything together in the Lagrangian and we have this Lagrangian multiplier. Now just a detail here. This works equally well for a constraint of the type g equals to zero, and also g less or equal to zero. The difference here is that the Lagrangian multiplier in this case must be positive, cannot be negative, so that we make sure we are on the right side of the constraint. Also, in the generalized Lagrangian, usually the beta values are reserved for these kinds of constraints, equal to zero, and alphas for this one. But since we only have alphas in support vector machine, and it's not important to go into much detail here, this is just for you to understand where the alphas come from, I'm using alphas everywhere. So basically, the Lagrangian method, we use this multiplier for the function that is serving as constraint. We put everything together, and then we find the solution by setting all the derivatives to zero. And this includes the constraint into our target function and allows us to find the solution. So let's see how we would solve this example. We compute the Lagrangian, we compute the Lagrangian is here, so the derivatives with respect to all the variables must be zero, and now we have a system of equations that we solve and we find the value for x and y that is the maximum of this surface subject to the constraint that we are moving along this line. Okay. So this is the general method that we're going to apply. So applying this to our problem of minimizing the size of the vector, the square of the size of the vector, subject to all these constraints. Remember that we have one constraint per example in our training set, but that's not a problem. The Lagrangian can be written just by adding the terms for all these constraints. But each one of those will have its own alpha value, its own Lagrangian multiplier. So we first just rewrite this. We have the margin greater than 1, this constraint that we put here. We just pass everything for the same to the same side and convert this into a less or equal to 0, which is what we need for the Lagrangian method. Yeah. See. So this is the smallest value that we allow for the product of the decision function by the class, which is a measure of the margin, not in the scale of the plot we're doing, but on the scale of the size of the vector that we're using. So we can change this arbitrarily by increasing the size of the vector. And now we are trying to minimize the size of the vector subject to these constraints. So when we write the Lagrangian, we have this sum. We can put the minus sign out here. And so we have the function that we want to minimize, the quadratic size, the size of the vector squared, minus this term, which is which has one, this sum, which has one term for each example in our training set. So each example has its own alpha, its own Lagrangian multiplier, its class, and then the product of the features by that vector that defines the discriminant. So we can compute what the derivatives must be, or how what the values must be when the derivatives are zero. So this W will have this form. The derivative also to the constant must be zero. So we have this additional constraint. We have the sum of the products of the alphas by the classes must be zero. These y values are all plus 1 or minus 1. So basically what this means is that the total size of the Lagrangian multiplier for one class must be the same as it is for the other. Okay. Remember that all these Lagrangian multipliers must be positive, 0 or larger, because they are for these inequality constraints. Okay, so now I'm going to skip a bit. There is one part here where we go from the primal problem to the dual problem. This is basically when we have optimization problems that involve maximizing something while minimizing some other thing. We can change or switch the maximization and minimization if the problem meets some criteria and still get the same result. But that part is quite a bit complicated, and it's not essential to understand support vector machines. So basically, let's just imagine that we are replacing this here, and then we pass on to the dual problem that gives us the same result. And now we have this problem represented only as a function of the Lagrangian multiplier. So all these alphas, each one corresponds to each example in the training set, and they are the Lagrangian multipliers that ensure that those constraints are met. The constraints are that all examples must be at least one away from the discriminant measured by that function. And then we have this additional constraint that the alphas must be greater than zero because they are Lagrangian multipliers for inequality constraints. And at the place where the derivatives are zero, the sum of the alphas multiplied by the classes must also be zero. So now we have this maximization to solve. We want to find the maximum of this expression as a function of the alpha, subject to these constraints. And the nice thing when we arrive here, one of them is that now we can solve this problem. This is a quadratic optimization problem that we have solvers for. It's a sort of a standard problem that we can solve. But we can also try to think about this intuitively. So we're going to try to maximize the sum of the alphas, but we have this constraint. So if we maximize the alphas for one class, we need to increase the alphas for the other two, because this constraint must be met. But then we are also penalizing according to this expression. And this expression is, for all pairs of examples, the inner product of the vectors of the examples multiplied by the classes of the examples multiplied by the alpha. So let's imagine that we have one example that is surrounded by examples of the same class. So examples of the same class, this will be higher when we compute the inner product of two vectors that are similar. The result is larger than if the vectors are too far apart, which then tends to reduce the value. So this will be dominated by those that are nearby, and since they belong to the same class, this will be positive. Since this will be positive and we are subtracting this from what we want to maximize, then the way to solve this is to set the alpha at zero. So basically all those examples that are surrounded by examples of the same class will tend to have alphas close to zero, and those are the examples we don't care about when classifying. If we start to go closer to examples from the other class, then we'll have terms in this sum where the classes are different, which starts to have a bigger weight because of the product of the vectors. And so now it may pay off to increase the alpha on that example, although we now have to increase the alpha on example on the other class because of this constraint. So basically what we have here is that those examples that are closest to the frontier will have an alpha that is greater than zero. And those that are away from the frontier will have an alpha of zero. That will be the result of trying to maximize this subject to this constraint. So the alphas let us identify the support vectors by being larger than zero. Also, from the support vectors, now we can compute the discriminant. But I'm going just to show you how we could theoretically implement this. You're not going to implement it, but the idea to write down some bits of code to show this is just to make it easier to understand what the expressions mean. So basically this here is a matrix which has all the inner products of all the pairs of examples multiplied by the classes of those examples. So we can create a matrix which has as many rows and columns as the number of examples that we have. And then we fill in the matrix by going for each row and each column. We compute the inner product of the vector of the example at that row and the example at that column, and then multiply by their two classes. So this is a large matrix that has the number of examples by the number of examples. If you have 1,000, it's 1,000 by 1,000 with all the inner products. Okay? So this we can call H, and this is what multiplies by the variables we're trying to optimize, so the alpha step. Now we can set this loss function, so the loss function is this expression here. Since we are maximizing, but we have a minimized function, we have to change the sign of the loss function, but so we start with this part positive. This is the inner product of all the alphas and the inner product of the matrix. So this is the matrix H. We multiply by all the alphas, and then we multiply again by all the alphas, and we can compute using matrix multiplication all those terms. And now we subtract this part. So this part is positive on the maximization. We want to do the minimization. We just subtract the sum of the alphas. We also need the derivatives. When you are solving a more complex optimization problem, it's useful to give the analytical derivatives to the solver because it makes it more efficient than try to compute the derivatives numerically. So this is basically just the derivative of the loss function with respect to the alpha. We can set that here, the Jacobian. And now we load the data. We use the minimized function on that cost function, but we also need to set the constraints. So basically our constraints are all the y values, so the class values. This is one constraint. This one here, all the y values multiplied by the class must be zero, and we have this constraint here for this function, and also the derivative of that function that has a constraint. So this is how you can specify a constraint optimization problem with SciPy. The additional constraint is that the alphas must not be negative, but we can set that here on the bounds. So we have this tuple with the lowest bound, or the low bound and the high bound, or lower bound and upper bound, and we have one for each value in our data set, which is one for each alpha that we're computing. Okay. So now we do the optimization. In this case, we only have these data. There are not many data points. And now we can find the solution. The solution here gives us a vector with all the alphas for all our data points. Now, this they will not be exactly zero due to rounding errors, but we can compare all of them with a very small number, for example, 1,000, and then see which ones have a larger value. So you see, nearly all of them are close to zero, except three that appear here, one true, one true, and one true. And these are the support factors. These are the examples that lie close to the margin. So these three here. And now we can go to the expression for the derivatives, and we can find, for example, here, when we computed the derivative at zero, we found what the W would be. It's just the sum of all the vectors multiplied by the class, multiplied by the Lagrangian multiplier. Since most of them have a zero on the Lagrangian multiplier, we can do this just looking at the support factors. Everything that is away from the frontier is irrelevant. The Lagrangian multiplier is zero. Those three support vectors are the only thing we need to remember after training the support vector machine. So we can use that to compute the W, and then the W zero we can compute from the W, because we know that this must be one for all the vectors that lie exactly at the margin, these support vectors. So we can take the average of this for all the support vectors, use the support vectors to compute the coefficients, and now we can draw the line. So this is how we can solve this problem, explicitly maximizing the margins by converting everything to this quadratic optimization problem that is solved as a function of the Lagrangian multipliers. The Lagrangian multipliers are those that allow us to incorporate the constraints on the expression.
We can apply the function for all of our data?
Yes.
Different sets of data, we can apply all the time the function, or the function varies from...
Well, when you're training, you apply this to the training data, you compute the alphas and the support vectors. Then you store the support vectors. You don't need anything else because the alphas for the rest are zero. And you use the support vectors to classify any new example, because you know where the discriminant is. In this case, we're going to see also that you can use the support vectors directly to classify the example, because you can use this expression. And so basically, if it's positive, it's on one class. If it's negative, on the other. But what you do is you train with the training data. You retain the support vectors. And then for classifying new examples, you just apply just to this calculation using the support vector. You don't change, don't train again the support vector machine. Okay. Okay, to sum up this part, the important thing here is the idea of the maximum margin. So we're trying to explicitly maximize the distance between the closest points to the discriminant and the discriminant. We saw that we could not solve this problem naively because the points keep changing, but we rewrote the problem differently in trying keeping the margin constant as measured as a function of the length of the vector, and then trying to minimize the vector to force the discriminant to be at the optimum place. This led us to a complex optimization problem, because we have to put all these constraints inside. We use the Lagrangian method to do that. So we have all these alphas, which are the Lagrangian multipliers, each one corresponding to one example in our training set. But then we could solve that problem, and we get, as the result, the values of all those alphas. And from that, we can identify the support vectors and compute the discriminant using those results. So this is how the support vector machine can be used to determine the frontier. But there is one additional thing. If you notice here, this expression is only as a function of the inner product of the examples and the alphas. We don't have anything else here. We don't have W and W0 anymore in the expression. We can get those later from the alphas. But this will be very useful when we see next, after the break, what we do with support factor machines. Okay.